Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Małgorzata Sankowska and I am a PhD student from the Institute of Nuclear Physics, Polish Academy of Sciences in Krakow. Today, I would like to talk a little bit about nuclear track detectors based on lithium fluoride crystals. I will focus mainly on the possibility of using them for spectrometry of ionizing radiation. However, I would like to start with some basic information on the concept of fluorescent nuclear track detectors, so-called FNTD. Fluorescent nuclear track detection technique is a method of ionizing radiation detection and imaging based on the photoluminescence of color centers which are created in crystals during its irradiation with ionizing radiation. This technique has been introduced over 10 years ago and was developed since then. First, and for the long time the only material successfully used as FNTD, was aluminium oxide doped with carbon and magnesium impurities. Only recently, the team from EFJ PAN Krakow succeeded in obtaining high-quality pictures using lithium fluoride crystals. Lithium fluoride is an especially interesting material for photoluminescence-based radiation measurements and dosimetry, as only ionizing radiation can effectively generate color centers in this compound. Usage of lithium fluoride crystals has some advantages over aluminium oxide crystals. Firstly, it doesn't require any additional activators introduced to the crystal lattice. What is more, while for aluminium oxide crystals, imaging of the tracks was performed with a confocal scanning microscope, for lithium fluoride, much simpler and less expensive, wide-field microscope was used. Ionizing radiation creates in lithium fluoride F-centers, anion vacancies trapping electrons, which tend to aggregate forming various more complex defects. Among them of special interest are F2 and F3+ color centers, which show a very strong photoluminescence emission. F2 center is composed of two anion vacancies with two bounded electrons, while F3+ of three vacancies with two electrons. Both those centers have overlapped absorption bands peaked around 445 nanometers. Photoluminescence spectrum consists of two bands, red at about 670 nanometers, which is related to F2 color centers, and green at about 530 nanometers, which is related to F3+ color centers. Lithium fluoride crystals used by our team were produced at EFJ PAN. They are grown with Czochralski method in argon atmosphere using undoped lithium fluoride powder as a starting material. Crystals are later cut with diamond saw into small samples of the standard size 3/3/1 mm and polished. Microscopic observations were performed using Nikon Eclipse NIU upright fluorescence microscope with CCD camera. For excitation, we used illumination system with 440 nanometers LEDs together with bandpass filter. As for emitted light, a long pass filter transmitting wavelengths longer than 570 nanometers was used. Now I would like to move to the possible applications of lithium fluoride-based nuclear track detectors. One of them is alpha particle spectrometry. The basic idea behind this method is pretty simple and utilizes the fact that the range of a particle in a given material is directly related to its kinetic energy. For our calculations, continuous slowing down approximation range of alpha particles in a lithium fluoride crystals calculated with ASTAR program was used. The length of the track registered with lithium fluoride detectors was established by measuring particles' depth of penetration and track's length in a plane parallel to the crystal surface. After that, Pythagoras formula is used to get overall track's length. Measuring particles' depth of penetration is possible thanks to the short focal depth of around 1 micrometer. We perform a series of pictures acquired with focus set at different depth into the crystal in 1 micrometer step, starting with the focus above the crystal surface. In that way, on each image, another part of the track is visible. If the focus is set below the penetration depth of a particle, no sharp image is observed. In the picture on the right side of the slide, we can see particle track in focus in the pictures from B to I. That would indicate that the depth of penetration of this particle is 8 micrometers. However, we can see that the last picture where the track can be seen, which is the I picture, the track is much less visible and less sharp than at the rest of the pictures. That means that actual penetration depth is actually shorter, probably around 7.5 micrometers. This part is somewhat subjective, and the resolution of penetration depth measurement cannot be better than 0.5 micrometer. For the measurements in the plane parallel to the crystal surface, we use so-called maximum intensity projection of the stack of images. This algorithm chooses from the picture series only the brightest pixel along the z-axis for each xy coordinate. As the pixels that are a part of the track are brighter than the other, which are out of the focus, we obtain the full xy projection of the analyzed track and we can then measure it. We have to remember that the depth of penetration should be always corrected for refractive index of lithium fluoride. After that, we can use Pythagoras' formula to calculate the length of the track. We can also establish the angle at which the particle entered the crystal by using simple geometrical relationship between penetration depth and the length of the track in a xy plane. To evaluate the correctness of the proposed method, crystal samples were irradiated with alpha particles from three radioisotope sources with well-defined energies: gadolinium-148, americium-241, and curium-244. The picture presents the maximum intensity projection obtained from the stacks of images taken for crystals irradiated with these three sources. The parameters of irradiation for each source are given in the table. We measured the lengths of the registered tracks for each source and related them to the appropriate value of alpha particles energy using continuous slowing down approximation range of alpha particles in a lithium fluoride crystal calculated with ASTAR program. In the picture, I present energy spectra obtained with our method in comparison to the energy spectra measured with the silicon detector. These data were obtained after correcting the raw results by subtracting from the length of each track a constant factor of 0.23 micrometer, as the initial data were found to be somewhat shifted with respect to the nominal values of alpha particles energy. This shift was most probably a result of a somewhat subjective measurement of the track's length. The next step of our studies was testing the possibilities of proposed method of alpha spectrometry in realistic conditions to check if it could have a practical application. We used lithium fluoride crystals to determine the energy of the americium-241 source installed in the RISO DA20 TLOSL reader. The nominal energy of this source is 5.486 MeV. Manufacturer of the reader recommends performing irradiations with alpha source in vacuum to avoid energy degradation. However, irradiation in air are also possible. For our studies, we tested both possibilities. In the pictures, we can see examples of the tracks registered in lithium fluoride crystals irradiated in vacuum on the left side and in the air, picture on the right side of the slide. It turned out that tracks for exposure in air are shorter by about 3 micrometers than those for detectors exposed in vacuum. Interestingly, the alpha energy spectra that we got by applying our method was very broad, and its peak position was much lower than the nominal energy of the americium-241 source, both for irradiation in vacuum and in the air, as can be seen in the graphs. The spectrum for vacuum exposure extends from about 1 megaelectronvolt up to 4.5 megaelectronvolt, with peak position at 3.1 megaelectronvolt. While for the air exposure, the respective values are 1 megaelectronvolt up to 3.5 megaelectronvolt, with peak at 2.2 megaelectronvolt. The reason is most probably energy degradation within a source material, as sources used in such irradiators are of relatively high activity and therefore rather thick, so the particles will lose the energy while traveling through the source. To test this theory, the spectra of this americium-241 source was also tested with the silicon detector, and similar results were obtained. They are presented with the black line at the left graph. It can be seen that the results for the silicon detector are narrower and don't have such prominent low energy part of the spectrum. The probable explanation for this are the conditions of the measurements. While for irradiations of lithium fluoride crystals, the source was installed in laser reader, for silicon measurements it had to be dismounted from the reader, and the source was shielded with 1 mm lead plate, in which a 1 mm pinhole was made, as the intensity radiation was too high to measure directly. This way, only the particles emitted nearly perpendicularly to the surface of the source could reach the silicon detector. Such particles lose less energy than others as they travel the shortest distance, and so the spectra is shifted. The discovered difference between the nominal energy and the measured spectra is rather important, as it can have a considerable influence on the results of the experiments performed with this and other similar instruments. Another field where lithium fluoride-based fluorescent nuclear attract detectors could be potentially used are heavy ions measurements. Irradiations for these studies were conducted mainly with the ion beams from the HiMag accelerator in Chiba, Japan. Detectors were irradiated in two geometrical arrangements, perpendicular and parallel to the ion beam. Besides irradiations with the pristine ion beams, some of the exposures were performed using PMMA absorbers, degrading ions energy. The pictures on the right side show examples of the tracks registered with lithium fluoride crystals. It was possible to observe and investigate tracks of helium, carbon, neon, silicon, and iron ions. In the pictures, we can see tracks of different ions obtained after irradiations with the beam perpendicular to the crystal surface. The shape and size of registered tracks were found not to depend on ion type and energy. It can be explained by the optical resolution limit, which is much larger than the actual size of the primary tracks created by these particles in lithium fluoride crystal. It was, however, observed that the brightness of the track, which was measured as the maximum intensity, increases linearly with the increasing ionizing density, linear energy transfer. At the graph, we can see this relationship for the tested ions. For the highest values of linear energy transfer, iron beam after crossing 50 to 70 millimeters of water equivalent, the data points lie below the trend line. This might be caused by the saturation of photoluminescence in the core of tracks due to the extremely high doses. For the lowest linear energy transfer values, below 10 kiloelectronvolt per micrometer, the detection limit seems to be achieved, as for the helium ions, the track intensity exceeded the background level by only 10 to 20%. Even though this method surely requires further work, it shows the possibility of extracting some spectrometric information on the radiation field with the usage of lithium fluoride crystals. Now I would like to shortly summarize the most important information from my presentation. Firstly, lithium fluoride crystals were with success used as fluorescent nuclear attract detectors. It is possible to detect and image ionizing radiation by using them. One of the potential applications of these detectors can be spectrometry of ionizing radiation. They enabled development of a new technique of alpha spectrometry that allows not only measurements of the energy of the alpha particles, but also the angle of incidence. Another application is linear energy transfer spectrometry of heavy ions, which seems to be possible. However, still much work is needed in this field. All the studies that were discussed during my presentation were performed by the team working at the Institute of Nuclear Physics, Polish Academy of Sciences in Krakow. The leader of our team is Professor Paweł Bilski, and here I present the rest of the scientists that are working on this project. If you are interested in this subject, here I present some articles published by our team on the topic of lithium fluoride crystals and their usage for the ionizing radiation detection and spectrometry. Thank you very much for your attention. If you have any further questions, please leave them in the comments section.